Welcome on the Barricades. This is a podcast produced by Eastern European journalists and academics, and this is your host, Maria Chernat. And with me, as usual, the Bulgarian-born Polish journalist Bojan Stanislavski, who decided to join even though he's feeling a little ill. Thank you for your effort and for being here with us, Bojan.
Thanks. It's always an honor and a pleasure to be on the Barricades.
So on November 14, Bulgaria held parliamentary elections for the third time since no coalition and no government were formed so far. For the first time in the history of the country, the parliamentary elections coincided with the presidential ones. The incumbent president Rumen Radev, a former army general, ran against Anastas Gherdzhikov, a university professor, but no candidate was able to receive the majority of the vote. So there will be a second round of presidential elections on November 21. The polls indicate that the incumbent president Rumen Radev will be the winner. In the parliamentary elections, the Bulgarian voted for the so-called Harvard Brothers, a duo formed by Kirill Petkov and Asen Vasilev from the party We Continue the Change. Although this may seem surprising, it is very traditional since the Bulgarians voted for a new set of saviors. We want to see who they are, what can be expected from them. And what about the left and its disastrous results? We are going to discuss this and other things today with Georgi Hristov, a Bulgarian leftist journalist and activist, and Stefan Georgiev, a sociologist and a researcher. They are both friends of the show and frequent guests. Let us introduce them both.
Right, don't go anywhere. On the Barricade starts right now.
So, hello again. Thank you for being here, both Georgi and Stefan. The Harvard Brothers, at least in terms of looks, it seems you are going in the right direction. I mean, we started with Borissov, then a mild improvement. So, that singer you had, Slavi Trifonov, and now a major improvement. So, in terms of looks, It looks like you're going in the right direction, but what about politics? Why are you voting? Why are Bulgarians keep voting for saviors? Who wants to go first? It is an honor to discuss with so many interesting and well-informed Bulgarians. So I will start with Stefan, if you want to go first.
Thank you, Maria, and thank you for the invitation for joining the podcast. On your question directly, politics in Bulgaria matters less and less for the past years, and this is obvious for everyone who observes the political process in the country. So basically now we have, like, as you call them, the new saviors, but the bad news in terms of our salvation, let's say, ironically speaking, is that the saviors are mini saviors already. We are not speaking about the way that we used to have in the beginning of the capitalist transition, let's say in the beginning of the 21st century. Now, if you take a look at the numbers and the results of the elections from last Sunday, you see that it is basically a little bit more than 600,000 people who supported the new political party. It was the similar process that we observed also during the summer with the Slavi Trifonov's party. There is such people. So what we see now is that there are this wave of voters that are looking for a new savior, but the savior is not a big one. It is a mini savior, let's say. And now this basically results into more and more fragmented parliament. This also means that we're going to have, let's say, a difficult negotiation process in terms of forming a government. And this is the one exactly the same that we observed during the summer. Now, at least the indications are a bit, let's say, brighter for forming a government during the upcoming weeks, as the tone is not so extreme, let's say, or it is not so assertive from the political parties that are about to take part into these negotiations. So this is just my first comment here, and I would let you speak, and I'm going to join the next minutes again.
Thank you. And I would like to give Georgios the possibility to tell us. So it looks better, but does it sound better? Is this something substantial?
Yes and no. After a few, this is the third attempt to form a government. So they, most probably there will be finally a government. But then again, in terms, when we speak about policy, it is not really substantial, because what the new coalition will offer most probably will be the same policies, but sort of cleansed without the feeling of corruption, which is so, which has defined the political landscape in the last few years. Otherwise, most probably it will be a right-wing government, even though a leftist party such as the Bulgarian Socialist Party will probably take part in it. But it is not a radical new approach when we talk about policies. Otherwise, yes, it's new faces. Some are completely new, never before taken part in any government whatsoever. So we'll see.
So right,
I just wanted to jump in for a short while, because I think it's extremely important what Stefan said at the beginning, that politics matter less and less. And that's this very sad fact which determines the quality of the political culture. And I think it has been like that for quite some time, maybe for the last two decades, as Stefan indicated. But this is this is one of the reasons, I think, why the Bulgarians do those things. I mean, I don't want to. I'm not one of those who's going to blame the public for making bad choices, because, as we know from sociology and from social psychology, people make the choices that they believe they have at their disposal. Okay. So they will, for example, I don't know, even if I have a great program, they will not vote for me, even if they like the program, because they just wouldn't think that I can deliver it, right? But I do think that this is a very important thing that Bulgarians don't learn from their own recent history. I mean, we first voted in someone like the former king, right? With the son of the former king, Simeon II, that was at the break of the century. And we voted in someone who has never had any relations, really, except for genetical, to Bulgaria, who has lived in Spain for the most of his life, who has had no political experience whatsoever, and we signed carte blanche for him. Then it's, you know, the former bodyguard of Todor Živkov, Boyko Borissov, right, who is just like, I mean, sorry, even if you look at him, right, I mean, you mentioned that the aesthetics are better now, because he does look like a thug. And this is, you know, and we voted him in, which was absolutely schizophrenic. I mean, he was promising, a person from the underground with a huge record of being a mobster was elected to fight the mob. I mean, this is, you know, and now we have those two beautiful green apples, one of them holding a Canadian passport. This is really ridiculous, and I'm saying that not because I want to blame the public again, but to demonstrate how far have we gone and to what kind of dark place. Okay, this is really, it's really bad, right?
I would say it's really bad, but I will come back to the question of corruption, because I think they both served, those Harvard brothers, one as the Ministry of Finance and one as the Ministry of Economy, and they wanted to expose corruption. Now, this is a major theme also in Romania. And I don't know, what do you think, Stefan? It gets always so much traction. I mean, people still believe that the system is perfect. And if we find non-corrupt leaders, everything will turn out just fine. Now, why is this that people go for such a simple narrative after 30 years?
it is one of the major outcomes of living and being ourselves also educated into the context of this capitalist transition that we already mentioned. But just allow me to go back just for a couple of sentences using the metaphor Bojan just used now about the green apples, because this is on the surface politics in Bulgaria. This is how it works. So imagine, I'm not going to speak about the aesthetics, but just if you are observing the process, you will agree that two green apples is a better choice instead of a rotten pumpkin, which is basically the nickname of the former prime minister, right? So basically,
I love your metaphor. I'm going to use it as a title for one of my next articles.
Yeah, please feel free. The point is that for us, it is very hard to transfer our political observation from the surface to the what is below the surface and what is the very core essence of the process. I'm saying that the politics matter less and less for the simple reason that pragmatic choices that are being offered to us seems much easier ones. Therefore, the political landscape, the political narrative is based on pragmatic choices, and pragmatic choices is always, as we all know, leaning to the right direction, right? And this is the fake alternative offered to the Bulgarian public. Pragmatic choices instead of ideologically coherent politics. So ideology matters less and less in the Bulgarian political narrative. We're not speaking about left or right. And this is exactly what the new guys, the Harvard boys, are exactly offering. It is the same offer repeating over and over again for 20 years. It is the same narrative. We don't care about left or right. We're just going to do the right choices. And it seems sexy. Let's admit that. It is easy dilemma for the majority of the voters. And if you have the rotten pumpkin just before, it is not so hard to embrace this alternative. In fact, the fact that we're not speaking about social issues anymore, even the Socialist Party is not speaking about social issues anymore, swings the pendulum towards the right direction, and this is the whole narrative that we've been surrounded with. So therefore, the choice of the majority of the Bulgarian voters, it's not so weird, basically, because we are always after the pragmatic decisions. The point and the trouble, basically, is that the democracy suffers, because if you take a look at the outcomes from the parliamentary elections last Sunday, you will see basically that the political representation is dropping down. It is, let's say, nearly 60% of the Bulgarian adult population above 18 years old are not represented into the new parliament. The winning party basically gained nearly 10% of all the voters. So we have like a fragmentation of the parliament. We have a lack of political representation, dropping down with every elections more and more. And we have a lack of ideological debate in the which should be the very core essence of the political process. This is it. We're going to have, and I agree with Georgi, right-wing government eventually, with or without the Socialist Party, at this point eventually with the Socialist Party. And this is not going to make huge difference in terms of the essence policies that are going to be implemented. Probably we're going to see another level of privatization of state.
Is there anything more to be privatized? I thought everything has been sold out.
If you look, you always find some. Right. Joke aside, now we're going to see another level of pragmatism in the middle of this healthcare hurricane that we are experiencing in Bulgaria and in fact Romania as well.
So I would like to give Georgi the opportunity to comment. I like very much what you said when you were previously invited to our show, that in Bulgaria we have a lot of competition, but literally no political pluralism. Do you stick by that observation?
Yes. Things have not changed in the last year or so. It's the same. So, and like I said, it's basically the same policies, but these are more the new guys are kind of sanitized without the corruption. So, but. Yeah, so this is what the voter is offered, a competition between different actors who all look in the same direction. So it's not really a choice. Also, I would like to say that there's a running joke in Bulgaria that the biggest party in the country is the party of non-voters. And these elections last week just proved that when the party of non-voters won by 60%. So, I think people realize that this is not real politics. This is what explains the low turnout at the elections and. There's a lot of ground for a leftist party, except there isn't one.
Mm-hmm. But I just want to say a little bit now on the Harvard brothers and discuss a little bit their political agenda and then move to what happened with Cornelia Ninova and the leftist Bulgarian party and why are they so... I don't know what the reason.
Maria, before we switch gears, can I just weigh in for?
Please. I was going to start with you now.
Okay, yeah, but I think it's extremely important what's been said now because first the question of democracy and how democracy is in decay, because of all those factors that were spoken about by Georgi and by Stefan. But look, this is essential if we are really serious about it because. Liberal democracy or any kind of representative democracy can only make sense if there is representation. And this is one of the most important problems that we have had with our democracy from the very beginning. And we're going to be talking now, in Bulgaria. We're going to be talking now about the Bulgarian Socialist Party. And, I got some heated remarks from certain Bulgarian leftists when I published an article where I indicated that the Bulgarian Socialist Party, despite all its failures and blunders and so on and so forth, has been actually the bedrock of the Bulgarian democracy. And here is why. Regardless of where it was in the polls and how many people have voted for it, when and how, this is the only serious party by any political categorization that you might want to apply to liberal democratic order, because this is the only party which has a stable electorate, not anymore, but it used to have throughout the last three decades, stable electorate, solid and weaker and kind of more volatile. And it claimed that it does represent that electorate and had it actually represented it for real, had it been serious about representing this electorate, they would have never gotten out of power. I mean, they would have really been there without any problems. It's just that they have never really been serious about their postulates and about representing their electorate because they were, and there are many factors here, we're going to probably talk about them later. But otherwise, we don't really have parties. We have a party like this party of the two brothers, the Harvard brothers. They are not brothers, really. I mean, the Harvard duo, okay? Which is a club hastily put together. Before that, we had GERB, which is, again, like a brotherhood of post-police mafia kind of, representatives. And Slavi Trifonov, I mean, what kind of party that was, right? So, and then also the last remark, the question of democracy. Look, if you want to have a serious democracy and a serious debate about politics and how the country is going to be governed, then you have to discuss exactly what Stefan pointed out and what Georgi also referred to, ideologies and ideas. Because we have this idiotic habit in Bulgaria that we first vote in for people and then look for what they could possibly do. Like, you first hire the man and then look for a job for him, which is a complete nonsense and everything is upside down. So, I just wanted to make that remark. I thought it matters. And off to you, Maria.
So, yeah, I would say that usually the electorate, especially in Romania and Bulgaria, act like they are going on a date. I mean, they like the guy, okay, let's go on a date. Well, you don't actually go to a date, you vote that guy. It's like marrying the guy, not dating him. So that might be of interest for those who think that, okay, let's just vote for this one because he looks appealing. So I want Stefan to discuss a little bit about these persons. I understand that they put forward the Harvard duo some important anti-corruption cases, and that was the bedrock of their political program and ideas. But besides that, what do they really advocate for? So would you like to comment on that, Stefan? Thanks.
Yes, at least I'll try. But because this is very
it's
hard
not
question.
Easy to say, right? What they say.
Yeah, it's very, very hard to answer. Because, okay, let's say that, again, using your metaphor, Maria, that we're about to have a date with these guys. But we're not quite sure to which restaurant they're going to bring us and what we're going to have for dinner. And this is a problem here. We have an anti-corruption rhetoric. And I'll try to explain why this is successful this time. Because if you take a look at the other political parties, let's say Democratic Bulgaria, this coalition, which claims to be right-wing, more or less, in Bulgaria, yeah. The main narrative for these guys for the past years is exactly the same, 100%. The point is that they didn't manage to show us that they're good at this. For a couple of months, the Harvard boys basically had the anti-corruption rhetoric, but they gave us a couple of examples for firing some members of board of the Bulgarian Development Bank and other financially related institution that they're managing the corruption, okay? They're going to be more functional, they're going to be more efficient. So compared to the Democratic Bulgaria coalition, they showed results. So this was very easy transfer of, let's say, several 100,000 votes just like this, because basically the audience saw the guys are efficient. Besides the fighting the corruption, we don't have very clear indications about how they're going to manage the political landscape. We have, let's say, unclear messages regarding the North Macedonia issue. We have unclear messages regarding the healthcare crisis. We are not really sure how they're going to manage, let's say, education. What we know for certain is that they say that they're not going to change the taxation system in Bulgaria.
Pathological.
Yeah. Which is, as you know, like the rightest one among all the European countries. So no change into the taxation system. And there's this statement that was made a couple of days ago by one of the, not the two guys, not the leaders, but another person who is, let's say, already recognized as a speaking representative of the political party, that he basically said that, not quoting, but rephrasing his thesis was, the salaries are not so low, but also the workers are not so willing to work. Or something like this. The point is that it is like classical neoliberal rhetoric. Yeah. So having all that said, we have indications that, as Georgi already said, we're going to have a right-wing policy ahead.
Yeah, that is so sad. And I want Georgi to comment a little bit on that, because usually also in Romania that anti-corruption was, let me tell you, like a magic wand for the politicians. And we saw, not like in Bulgaria, but in Romania, we had a whole show. We had major political leaders, you know, paraded in front of TV cameras in prime time and taken to the DA's office. It was quite a show, but nothing happened. Don't you fear like the same thing is going to happen in Bulgaria? I mean, a lot of show and no real things and changes?
Yeah, well, it has already been happening here because for the last 6 months we had a caretaker government, which involved in the beginning those two Harvard boys also. So there were a lot of activity which tried to exactly posing for the cameras, look how we're fighting with corruption and stuff like that. But so far, no results, which is, of course, also due to the fact that the previous government, the GERB party, has taken control of the prosecutor's, the general prosecutor's office. So there's that. But then again, we haven't seen much of evidence except for posturing before cameras. So yeah, we'll see how the question with corruption will develop. So far, yes, nothing happens. But I wanted to say something also about corruption, is that nobody talks about how the system creates corruption. Nobody is willing to talk about how the more richer parts of society can influence politics, get government contracts and stuff like that, which is defined as corruption, but it's just a function of the system, actually. So this is a big problem too.
Yes, I would say so. Now I want to go to Bojan and ask him something about the left in Bulgaria. You wrote a quite critical piece on the leadership of the Bulgarian Socialist Party, and especially about this leader, that is Cornelia Aninova, and you said that there is basically no chance for the Bulgarian left to move anywhere if this person is still there. Do you maintain your position or?
Yeah, sure. I don't think it's controversial on the Bulgarian left. I mean, even those who are not like, you know, those who are not the hardliners, like on the left, like, you know, the three of us, for example, here in the studio. But like everyone understands that, even the most opportunist elements, I think, in the Bulgarian Socialist Party understand that this woman is dragging this party down and has been dragging this party down pretty much ever since she became a leader of that. And now, I don't want to go into speculations whether this is on purpose, some people suggest that, or whether this is just out of plain stupidity and lack of political education and understanding of what means to be left and so on and so forth. Both are possible. Maybe both are actually in play. I mean, both of those elements are in place. I don't know. But she's extremely stubborn and extremely ignorant, and she has this idea, as many leaders have had over the last years or decades really in Eastern Europe, that it makes sense to be right wing or to posture as right wing in order to gain points, because apparently some people, many people actually think, particularly those influential in terms of media coverage and so on and so forth, that the society is right wing. So we have to adapt somehow to this right wing society. And they don't kind of understand the mechanism that the more you offer right-wing solutions and the more you fill the air with right-wing solutions, the more acceptable they will become. But they were not like that. I mean, you know, the Bulgarian society, and please correct me if I'm wrong, if you feel I am, but has been crying for a leftist alternative over the last three decades and has constantly been offered right-wing governments and right-wing solutions, right? Including the Bulgarian Socialist Party as well. I mean, the pathological tax system, who introduced it? The Bulgarian Socialist Party. Troops to Iraq, who sent them? The Bulgarian Socialist Party. You know, and the list is long, right? So, and now it's just worse than ever. I mean, with this, Cornelia Ninova is like absolutely crazy. She really thinks that instead of discussing real politics, which everybody should be wanting to and willing to, it's better to actually try and produce hot air about gender ideology, quote unquote, or whatever, the Istanbul Convention, right? Because it's going to somehow destroy the families and so on and so forth. So this is just pure nonsense, and also her attempt or attempt on the part of the Bulgarian Socialist Party to create some kind of left, quote unquote, leftist conservatism, which is a complete nonsense, like from any point, like whatever, however you want to look at it, right? I mean, there are people who are slightly conservative and have leftist demands, but it doesn't mean that they need a separate body of ideas to service, you know, their kind of ideological confusion. It's like if you are ideologically confused, then you don't change the entire system of political philosophy just to service a few people. But that's a whole different show. So yeah, I'm totally against it. And if anyone wants to understand my arguments or see them, they could just go and read the article that I wrote. But I also want to make one more important remark here about corruption. And it's going to be very short because the guys have said pretty much everything. But if anyone keeps, like the question of corruption regarding Bulgaria and Romania and some other Eastern European states, this is a Western narrative imposed on us. And why is this narrative in place? It is in place because it helps justifying in front of other Western governments, partners, businesses, whatever, it helps justify why is the situation so bad. So instead of saying that the situation in Bulgaria is so bad because the entire transition to capitalism has been one huge disaster, they're going to tell you everything was fantastic until the corruption kicked in. And now it's corruption. And, you know, many people just got convinced because of this cliche, got convinced that, yes, Bulgaria would be great if we only took corruption away. Guys, you want to think about it, because for the last 30 years, Bulgarian statehood has been nothing but corruption, really. And if you take away corruption, you might just take down the entire modern Bulgarian statehood. And this is a very, very big, I would say, major systemic problem.
Yes, I would say so. And in Romania, we are so self-colonized that we deeply believe that the problem is us, that we are corrupt, that we are rotten to the bone, and it is our fault, basically. And this is a very perverse victim blaming, you know, of the system. It is not the system, it is you. But I want to go now also to Stefan and then to Gheorghe about this Cornelia Ninova. Well, look, so from a feminist perspective, she might be very progressive. So we have a political leader. She's a woman, and some feminists might actually say that this is a very good thing. But when you look at it, she wants to take Bulgaria out of the Istanbul Convention. So
no, she doesn't want to sign it. Bulgaria.
Oh, she doesn't. Oh. Okay, sorry. Oh, at this I remember because I taught a class at the New Bulgarian University and people were so afraid that the homosexuals are going to come and steal the Bulgarian babies. Yes, yes, I remember now. So how is this working out? I mean, you have a female leader, but at the same time, she's so conservative.
Bojan said pretty much what's supposed to be said, in fact, and I agree with him. The point is that, yes, in the beginning, 5 years ago, she seemed a progressive with a lot of energy, with the intention and also the capacity of drag the Bulgarian Socialist Party out of the crisis that it was the party already into 5 years ago. The point is that the more you observe, the more you realize it wasn't about tactics, as Bojan suggested, that she's basically playing this right-wing narrative in order just to support right-wing voters. The more you observe, the more you realize it's about ignorance, I think, and probably it's not a personal issue, probably it's something which is related to the head body of the Socialist Party, like the board, the so-called board. Now, but it is a simple truth that basically if we are on the football pitch, you see that the right half of the football pitch is crowded and the left one is basically empty one. No one's willing to play on the left part of left half of the football pitch on the stadium. And she's dragging the Socialist Party more and more into the right direction, which is reaching already absurd dimensions. If you imagine that the so famous or the so infamous, let's say, Istanbul Convention and this gender ideology that is basically circulating into the narrative from the early morning till the late evening. This is the boogeyman of Cornelia Ninova. You know, all the political parties in Bulgaria, they have this fixation about something. Let's say the classical right wingers, they have this fixation about the communism is coming. Yeah. We have this Soviet monument in downtown Sofia that when elections approach and the right wingers start demolishing the monument, like this is the biggest issue in the Bulgarian political life. It is the same thing with Cornelia Ninova and the gender ideology. When elections approach, she starts showing this gender boogeyman is about take away the kids or going to transfer all the traditional Bulgarian families into some, orgy or something. I don't know what is in her imagination. But basically, this is the narrative, which is absurd because it couldn't be further from the real political conversation. Therefore, it is not a surprise that now the political representation for the Bulgarian Socialist Party is nearly 3% or 3% from all the voters. It is less than 300,000 votes. Which is a catastrophe. And what I see from her statements for the past days is that, she resigned, but probably she's going to find in a tactical way to be back as a head of the Socialist Party after the upcoming Congress in a couple of months.
So for the final remarks, how do we escape the situation, Georgi, where we have so much competition because there is fierce competition, but no pluralism because pretty much everybody says the same, even though if they are agitating the ghosts from the bathroom, as Stefan said, or they are agitating the ghosts of the past, like the communists, but each and everyone is presenting some sort of non-existent boogeyman. So how do we get out of here? Do you see some perspectives, Georgi?
There are two ways. Either we have to form a brand new leftist party, or we can hope that there's still some reason left within the Bulgarian Socialist Party, which will get it, which will return it to its roots. I don't see no other way. It will have to be one of those, but both these options seem very unrealistic at the moment. Because the problems of the Bulgarian Socialist Party will not end with Cornelia Ninova. There was an active campaign of cleaning almost everyone who is leftist, so that she doesn't have any opposition. So now the most of the party are people who think like her, and this is very bad because, as Stefan said, they play only in the right part of the field, and when you play only on the right side of the pitch, then you only have two options. You either have to radicalize yourself in the direction of liberalism or conservatism, but none of it is real left-wing politics.
Yeah, so said. I would like to go to Bojan now for the final remarks and ask him, do you see any alternative at this point? Because let me warn you guys about what happened in Romania. We finally got the Union Save Romania in power, and that was the dream of the Romanian right-wing intelligentsia that is mainstream in Romania and quite dominant, heavily dominating the media and the public area. And unfortunately, it was the biggest disaster. So, yeah, don't you fear the same will happen in Bulgaria? And do you see a way out, Bojan?
At the moment, not really. And I'm pretty pessimistic. But, look, I mean, forming a viable leftist party is a very difficult endeavor anywhere in the world. And in a society so apathic and so demoralized like the Bulgarian one, And again, by saying that, I'm not trying to blame the public for all the problems of Bulgarian politics, but we are very demoralized and we are very detached from things which go above the question of daily survival. That's how are you going to discuss politics and ideas with someone whose main concern is whether they're going to be able to survive this month or not? Like, this is very difficult. I mean, you know, in certain situations, when to use the Marxist formula, the objective factor is out there, then you might have some, you know, revolutionary energy in the society, which if you have a viable mass party of labor, you might want to use for certain purposes. But this is not the situation in Bulgaria right now. And this is not the situation in Romania. It's not the situation pretty much throughout Eastern Europe at the moment. Because the 3 decades of this capitalist experiment, and let's just be honest with it, without going ideological about capitalism, okay, it just failed. It doesn't work for the people, and look, there are so many indicators about it. For example, one of the cliches that Bulgarian parties like to exploit, that speaks to what Stefan indicated earlier, they have fixations. And one of the fixations, which is basically shared by many parties, is the demographical disaster in Bulgaria. And there is demographical disaster, obviously. And we have been talking about this demographical disaster for the last, 13 years at least, right, since Bulgaria joined the EU in 2007. So over the 13 years of this discussion about the disaster, we have not come to any conclusions. And then, you know, we have this competition, which is who's going to produce more hot air about poverty in Bulgaria or more hot air about the demographical disaster. But there is no real competition in terms of ideas. That's just competition in terms of maybe PR, who's going to be more heartbreaking or, you know, no touching about this. And that's it. And then people are going to go and cast their votes as if they're exactly either going on a date or it's a casting for those who's going to steal now from me or who's going to, you know, be in charge of the mess. So they just cast their votes. And, you know, it's so damaging, okay, for the entire culture, okay, for the civilizational concept of where we are and a sense of place that we could have. Because think about it, the political process should be something which you exercise with some kind of enthusiasm or at least hope, right? And then, you know, you go, as most of the Bulgarians do, and this is my, you know, I don't have data to support this speculation, but I think it's an educated guess that, you know, people go and vote for the National Assembly, not in order to be able to observe afterwards how the MPs enter into dialogue about certain politics. They vote for them in order to be able to shout at them right after the first day of the plenary session of the new National Assembly is over. And they're going to call them all kinds of names, thieves, you know, corrupt people, you know, bastards and all, whatever, like, right? But they just voted for them, right? This is a very complicated and I would say very pathological situation which we are in right now. And the only way that I see out right now is if there is, at least some kind of vision which turns out to be inspiring. And unfortunately, the Bulgarian Socialist Party's politicians, for example, they feel that such a vision would be a right-wing conservative one where we would defend the family, quote-unquote, from quote-unquote gender ideology. And this has not gained traction, really. Yeah, I just saw Stefan.
You want to say something?
Yeah, just add to Bojan's point. You see, let's take this demographic issue. You see, it's been repeatedly explained as a demographic catastrophe. But the point is, it's a poverty catastrophe. It's not about demographics. It's poverty. First of all, families cannot afford, let's say, having, let's say, 2 or 3 kids. And the major factor is basically the immigration. And the immigration is comes as a outcome of the poverty. So the point that we're not calling it poverty catastrophe, we're calling it demographic catastrophe. And then we're looking at the right-wing narrative and say, okay, for this family crisis, we're going to blame the gender ideology. So it's a vicious circle, you know. So we're not stating the problem, which is quite obvious, or at least for me. We're just faking it, and then we have this boogeyman to blame. And this is repeatedly happening all the time throughout the years. And then we're in this vicious circle that we cannot escape from.
Well, quite depressing, I would say. But who knows, maybe at some point we'll get tired of all this PR, all these myths that are being sold to us, because they are extremely detrimental, and they are the ones that keep us from seeing the root of the problem, seeing that there is, as Gheorghe so wonderfully put it, a lot of competition, but no real alternative. And probably opt for a different kind of politics and get more involved, because I think this is the only way to go about it. What we're doing here, I think, is very important, because it creates some sort of counter-narrative to the dominant ones blaming corruption or blaming us, basically, the victims of the system and not the system itself. I hope you enjoyed the show. For me, it was wonderful to have the opportunity to discuss with such informed and nuanced journalist and activist from Bulgaria. Thank you all for being here with us. And for the viewers, please go and support us. Go to patreon.com/theparricade, be our supporters, because we rely on you. And stay healthy, keep fighting, and we'll see you in our next episode.